church. A good chilly morning to you. I don't know. Maybe I shouldn't say this for the folks who are at home. The reason that I have my coat on is we had a little glitch with getting the heat going. So if I'm doing this a lot, I don't have evil devices. I'm just people like my hands warm. A couple of announcements that we want to make you aware of. March 4th from 4 to 7, Tell High Camp is going to have a lasagna drive-through dinner this time. I know their turkey drive-through dinner was delicious. So 4 to 7 on March 4th, you can call or email for a reservation, and I won't. The information is in your bulletin, or we can post it on the website. There's also going to be a Bible study that's going to be starting up on March 8th from 11 to noon, called "Jesus and Me" by Anne Graham Lotz. Talk to Diane Palmer or Lynn Vanderhoof if you'd like to go. There's going to be an event through the Point. Brian Dawkins, NFL Hall of Famer, is going to be speaking about mental health issues at Aquarer High School on March 16th, 7 to 8:30. That information is also on our Facebook page. And the Women's Conference is coming up. And also, not in your bulletin, but I purchased some of these little devotionals with your whole heart. They're devotions for Lent. They're very short. They also have some family activities, some things that you can do together. So if you have kids or grandkids, or you just are kind of a big kid yourself, and even if you're not, there's some great devotions in here. The copies are up front. I think they cost like $1 a piece. If you'd like to donate towards that, that's fine. Just put $1 in the plate. But if not, just go ahead and take one anyway. So they're up here. Finally, we are going to have a work day again at Tell High, but we're not totally sure. It's either going to be this coming Saturday or the Saturday after, and we're not sure. But we'll have that information. Terry was going to be in touch with Brian Williamson, and we'll let you know. It'll be on the Facebook page, and if you want to call the office, or I'm sure they'll send out an all call letting people know about it. Finally, he's not here, and I forgot last week, but Jim Rice is engaged, so we're very happy for Jim. If you're listening, Jim, yay. If you're not, yay anyway, and say congratulations to him when you see him. Whew, that's a lot of stuff. Also, I wanted to mention, obviously, we're all very aware and concerned and horrified about what's happening in Ukraine. One great hour of sharing emergency relief funds have already released $15,000 from the Baptist to the European Baptist Federation to provide humanitarian aid for Ukrainian Baptists. Obviously, that's going to kind of be a drop in the bucket. So if you would like to give to help folks in Ukraine, and you can give through One Great Hour of Sharing and just say that's what it's for in Ukraine. And one of the things that I love about One Great Hour of Sharing is not only the fact that, you know, the money that you've given in the past, they're able to go, okay, they need money tomorrow before we can get new fundraising efforts, so they're able to give that. But also because you're giving it to church people in that area who know the need and can help very directly. So that money is going very directly to people in need. Anything else that we should be mentioning at this point? All right. Let us prepare our hearts as we listen to Wholehearted.
Help me dance like a little child. Help me go just a little while. I've become far too civilized. Give me eyes wide with wonder and a heart of praise. Give me passion down in my soul. Give me fire from the Holy Ghost. Now it's time to start letting go.
To give ourselves fully to you, even as we come into this time of worship, O God, that we would set aside anything that would distract our minds and our hearts from you, and Lord, that we would be people who love you and seek you with our whole hearts. These things we pray in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Now, if you would take your hymnals and stand, and we will sing Wholeheartedly.
Thank you.
I just heard from you. Don't shake your head like that. This is, I'll sing with you guys. Okay? And you guys have to start. Okay?
No, the whole thing. Right?
So you'll be the second ones. Right here.
Okay, are they doing just the chorus or
no? What's that?
Just the chorus?
No, the whole thing.
Okay.
We won't get the harmony if we don't do the whole thing. Right? All right. Last Monday, Macy's count dropped from 485 to 60. She's back in the hospital. As you probably remember, it's supposed to be around 500, so it was very close to what it was supposed to be. A lot of tests, still don't know where the infection is. Then she came home Friday, still doing chemo, starting Monday for 5 days. She's very unstable right now. Lifting her and her family and her doctors up, as I know you continue to do. Barb is home, recovering from pneumonia. She was in Paoli for a while, or she was in the hospital anyway for a while. Barry and Doris, Barry's coming along with his therapy after his hip surgery. Sarah's still dealing with a lot of back pain, and this week she's starting tests. We said last week she's going to be having tests like every week during March, so just pray that they figure out what's going on and how best to treat her and relieve her some of that pain. Continue to pray for Suzanne for strength and healing, and of course Bert as the one who's taking care of her and trying to take care of the home and everything else, so be with him. Also, some of you who knew that Jamie's brother had been dealing with serious health issues for, well, a long time. He's had multiple issues, but continue to pray or start praying for Jamie's brother and for the family. I mean, he needs transplants. He's very seriously ill, so please be praying for him. Any other prayer requests? And obviously, as I mentioned, we want to be praying for the situation in Ukraine. That's just terrifying. Yes.
There's a group from Tel Hai and from the Methodist Church in Israel. They left yesterday.
Oh, wow. Okay. Tel Hai trip. They went to Israel, left for Israel yesterday.
Mark took a few, too.
Okay. Yeah. Some Methodists. And I just, you know, if you're on Facebook, you know that they have pictures pop up, and I just have been having my 5-year anniversary of going to Israel. Pictures pop up, and it's like, oh my goodness, it's been 5 years. How did that happen? So pray for the Israel trip. Anybody else? Someone mentioned. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, I probably say this every week that I'm so grateful that we can come, but it's always true. I'm so grateful that we can take these concerns, Lord, that can be so weighty and heavy and even at times discouraging, and we can lift them to you. We can know that you hear. We can know that all these situations continue to be in your hand. Lord, we don't understand why things work out the way that they do, but we trust you, and we continue to lift these things to you and pray that you would intervene. Lord, we continue to lift up Macy, and we know that with all the struggles she's had, as hard a year as it's been, it's also a miracle that she's still alive. Lord, we pray that for that blood count, we pray for the tests and the doctors, and Lord, that they would find out what's going on, that you would destroy the infection in her body, that you would heal her, oh God. We pray that you would restore her to health. Pray that you would restore her and allow her to be the little girl that she is. Lord, I pray that you would surround her family and just all of them. Give them peace and hope, and just help them to know that you're walking with them, and that we are lifting them up as well. We pray for those who are continuing to heal and strengthen. We're grateful that Barb is recovering and that Barry's doing well. We pray for Suzanne to continue to heal and grow stronger. And we pray for Bert as he helps to care for her and all the other things in their lives. Lord, we lift Doris to you and pray that the tests that she's having would reveal what's going on, and that the doctors would know how best to treat her, that she would be relieved of her pain. And Lord, we pray for Jamie's brother. We ask for healing and for your presence and peace for Jamie and just the whole family. Bless and be with them, oh God. We pray for the Israel trip, Lord, keep them safe, and I pray that you would minister to their hearts and souls as they have this amazing experience together. And Lord, we lift up this horrible situation in Ukraine and just seeing apartment buildings bombed and people driven out of their homes. And Lord, I ask for peace. I ask that you would stand in the way of all that is bringing war and hate in that place. Lord, I almost feel like that cry is also the cry in our hearts, oh God. And I ask that you would intervene as only you can. Help us to trust you, to be faithful in praying and giving and support of these folks. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.
Amen.
So, how you doing? If you said that to somebody and they asked you what you meant by the question, what would you say? Would you say, when I say how you doing, I mean, I want to know about your life. I want to hear about your joys and sorrows. Let's sit down and have a cup of coffee together. Well, you know, I don't know about you, but that's not usually what I mean. It's kind of a phrase that just kind of comes popping out of my mouth. I often say it to somebody I see in passing. You know, my neighbors are across the street. Hey, how you know? I'll say it to strangers, grocery clerks, or waiters. It's mostly just something polite to have to tack on when I say hi. As if it's, you know, just not long enough. Hi is just not long enough, so I want to say something polite. Right? So, how you doing? While I was in seminary, I had the blessing of meeting a lot of wonderful Christians from all over the world. They were kind of confused sometimes by how you doing, because they thought it meant, how are you doing? But one day, a student that I knew just a little bit, he was from India, and he startled me by looking me in the eye very seriously and saying, how is it with your soul, sister? And I kind of went, whoa, I know how to answer how you doing, but how is it with your soul? I soon discovered that this was his normal greeting. That's what he said to people. And he was always ready to listen to the answer. Today's scripture challenges us with a similar question. How is it with your heart? Maybe you don't know how to answer that. That's another question that might not be the easiest thing to answer. But hopefully as we go through 2 Chronicles 25, we'll get a better answer to that question. We're going to be reading about a king named Amaziah who reigned about 200 years after King David. Amaziah's story is a long one, so I'm only going to give you some background, summarize the story, and just read just a few verses from the chapter. And if you find Amaziah to be an interesting guy, you know, you can read his whole story this afternoon. You may remember that not long after King David was king, 200 years prior, Israel had split into two separate kingdoms. Southern kingdom called Judah had all the things we associate with Israel, right? Jerusalem, the temple, and all their kings were descendants of David. That was the lineage that God had placed in power. The northern kingdom had none of those things, but was still called Israel. And that northern kingdom of Israel almost immediately fell away from the Lord. Judah had her ups and downs, largely dependent on whether they had a good king honored God and served with integrity, or a bad one who did not. Second Chronicles is a record of all the kings of Judah and always begins with a summary about each king. Sorry. As in the first couple verses in 2 Chronicles 25, verses 1 and 2 say this. Amaziah was 25 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 29 years. His mother's name was Jehoadam, and she was from Jerusalem. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, but not wholeheartedly. I was really caught by that verse 2 the first time I read it, and I every time after that, I've kind of been caught by it. I don't know about you, but sometimes I find myself going through the motions, even in my walk with God. And I think as we've gone over the last 2 years of the pandemic, so much in our lives has changed, and then changed again and again. It can be exhausting. Mental health experts say many of us are going through something they call languishing. It's not downright depression, but it's not really thriving either. And even while restrictions are being lessened and things seem to be getting better, things are getting better, we may feel those pandemic feelings of languishing robbing our joy. Like Amaziah, we may be doing the right things, but not wholeheartedly. And as we look at Amaziah's life, I hope it helps us to live more wholeheartedly. So Amaziah becomes king in Judah after his father was assassinated. Most kings in that situation just not only would kill the people who had committed the crime, but their whole families as a security measure. But in obedience to the law of Moses, Amaziah doesn't do that. He holds the murderers accountable, but he doesn't punish their whole families. This was one of the ways that Amaziah was doing what was right in the eyes of the Lord. Next, we see him mustering his forces in preparation for an attack on the nation of Edom. In order to beef up the army, he hires an extra 100,000 mercenaries from Israel, in the north. Big, tough guys, professional warriors. But a prophet comes and says to him, "You can't use these guys. You have to get rid of them, or God is not going to help you win." Frequently in the Old Testament, the Lord instructs his people not to make such military alliances, lest they trust in foreign armies rather than God himself. And although they had been one kingdom at one point, Israel was just about pretty much a foreign country at that point. Well, at first, Amaziah balks, because he has paid out the equivalent of $3 million to these guys already. Now, I know that sounds like a lot, but it was 100,000 people, so that's only 30 bucks a piece. They hadn't come to risk their lives for 30 bucks, though, but so that they could plunder the people who they fought. That was just like a little incentive, gas money to get there. So that then the real money came later. So that meant they were not happy campers when they were told to go home, and that'll come into play later. But the prophet tells him, God is able to give you far more. And Amaziah, to his credit, sends them away. After giving them $3 million, he's like, okay, God tells me to do that, that's what I'll do. Again, Amaziah does what's right, even though it cost him dearly, trusting that God was a better partner than 100,000 big burly guys. And he is. Judah wins the battle decisively, a sign of God's favor, of his honoring Amaziah's obedience. That's the first part of verse 2 playing out, that he did what was right in God's eyes. But then he does something completely shocking. After he wins this battle in Edom, he steals their idols, the statues, and sets them up in their own little shrine and starts bowing to them in worship. I mean, God's given him this great victory. You'd think he'd be praising God at the top of his lungs and smashing the idols like David did when he was in similar situations. But he makes this total U-turn, rejecting God for dead statues. In verses 15 and 16, we read, "The anger of the Lord burned against Amaziah, and he sent a prophet to him who said, 'Why do you consult this people's gods, which could not save their own people from your hand?' While he was still speaking, the king said to him, 'Have we appointed you an advisor to the king? Stop, why be struck down?' So the prophet stopped, but he said, 'I know that God has determined to destroy you because you have done this and have not listened to my counsel.'" Obviously very harsh words, but the king had a powerful influence on what happened throughout the kingdom. And so his turning away was even worse than just one individual. But we got to say one thing for Amaziah. He's not half-hearted anymore, is he? He's moved from lukewarm obedience to ice-cold rebellion. He's deliberately turned his back on God. And it's a sign of God's tremendous mercy and his desire to see Amaziah repent that he sends the prophet at all. Amaziah knew perfectly well he wasn't supposed to be bowing to idols. But he sticks to his idols and his pride. Idolatry occurs when we put anything else in God's rightful place. It's rarely a conscious attempt to take God off the throne, but an effort to squeeze that thing we idolize on the throne with him. But the minute we worship God and someone else or something else, we're saying God's not enough. I don't just need God, I need God and. A former pastor of me once brought a blackboard into the sanctuary and drew these two equations. He said, Jesus plus X, which is anything, equals nothing. If we say we're going to trust in Jesus, but also money or also something else, then we end up like Amaziah, not having either of those things. But Jesus plus nothing is everything. We're able to seek God first wholeheartedly, one and only. We often don't even realize something has taken God's place until it's threatened. Mother Teresa said, "You'll never know Jesus is all you need until he's all you've got." What's frightening to me about Amaziah's fall into idolatry is that one minute he's serving God, and the next he's prostrating himself before an image of silver or gold. What was happening that made him pivot like that? And I think the answer is back in verse 2. He did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, but not wholeheartedly. Even when he was doing what was right, his heart just wasn't in it. Obedience is important, but it's not enough. God's after a heart that is fully devoted to him. Amaziah had some level of faith, but it was a lukewarm faith. It wasn't sturdy enough to stand strong in the face of one of the most difficult challenges we face in our faith. That challenge was victory. You think, well, victory? Victory's not a challenge. Victory's just fun. I get why defeat would be, but why victory? Well, because victory tempts us to pride, to thinking we did it on our own. Even though it was obvious God had given Amaziah victory, he told himself he was the one who had done it. And idols are not jealous, right? They let you take all the credit even when it's not yours. You probably heard someone say he's a self-made man who worships his creator. And that was what Amaziah had become. Pride is incompatible with worshiping God. Not that we're ever going to weed out every bit of it, but it's something we watch our hearts for. Predictably, Amaziah's pride leads him to foolish and even reckless behavior. He challenges Israel, the northern kingdom, to battle. He gives no reason for this, but presumably he wants to get revenge for the damage done by the Israelite mercenaries. Remember the $30 guys? Well, they had to truck home from Jerusalem north back to Samaria, and so as they were going, they just decided, they owe us some pillaging, so we're going to pillage. So they would, you know, they raided these towns on the way home. Now, attacking Israel was a stupid idea on Amaziah's part, certainly not one he got from God. The king of Israel, Jehoash, who certainly was no saint, recognizes Amaziah's behavior for what it is when he says in verse 19, "You say to yourself that you have defeated Edom, and now you are arrogant and proud." Amaziah thinks he and his Edomite gods are invincible. He's unfazed by Jehoash's warning or their superior military strength, and so they go to war. And guess what? Without God's help, Judah gets whipped. Judah's army turns and runs. Amaziah is captured, but they don't kill him. They take him back to Jerusalem, his own capital, and no doubt let him watch as they tear down 200 yards of the northern wall of the city, leaving them defenseless. As if you've been in Israel, you're picturing the wall that went around the city. And notice that he damaged the northern wall, right? The wall that faced Israel, and it was just kind of a symbol of, we can come and do whatever we want, whenever we want. And you can't do a darn thing about it. They plunder the temple, they plunder the palace, and they take Amaziah as a prisoner to Samaria, the capital of the north. And Judah is left without a defense, without a leader, and with their place of worship in shambles. Amaziah's sin and pride have cost him and his country dearly. After 10 years, they release him. He returns to Judah and actually reigns for another 15 years until he's chased from his own palace, hunted down, and assassinated by his own people, as his father was. You know what rumble strips are, right? We've all seen them on the highways, in the middle and on the sides, so that if you kind of drift off like that. In 2019, PennDOT reported that there had been a 50% decrease in certain types of crashes since 2002, thanks to the 6,000 miles of rumble strips they've laid down. With all of the reports of increasingly distracted drivers, rumble strips definitely get your attention. Amaziah's story is like those rumble strips. It's supposed to rattle us if we start to veer off. Amaziah heard the rumble through the prophet, but he chose to keep driving off the road until it was too late. Amaziah teaches us that a lukewarm heart left unattended can easily turn cold. Proverbs 14:23 says, "Above all else, guard your heart. For it is the wellspring of life." It means pay attention to the rumble strips. Take inventory of what's going on in your heart and your relationship to God, because it's so easy to drift. It's so easy to go from warm to lukewarm to cold. When we talk about the heart, we usually just think of our feelings. But when the Old Testament talks about the heart, or the New Testament for that matter, it includes not just our feelings, but our mind, our will, our spiritual nature. It embodies the whole life of a person. To serve God with the whole heart is more like the New Testament phrase that we should love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. So easy to slide into half-hearted faith. It seems like it'd be easier to live that way too. Maybe in some ways it is, but we miss out on some great perks. Hudson Taylor, who was a great saint, a missionary pioneer, said this: "The real secret of an unsatisfied life lies too often in an unsurrendered will." Drifting along in half-hearted devotion is a very unsatisfying way to live. Life takes on more meaning and even joy when we're all in with our walk with God. In his book, Finding God, Christian psychologist Larry Crabb writes this: the core problem is not that we're too passionate about bad things, but that we're not passionate enough about good things. If you were to flip back a few pages to 2 Chronicles 15, there's a scene that's the exact opposite of what we read today. God's people join together. Starting in verse 12, they say, excuse me, they entered into a covenant to seek the Lord, the God of their ancestors, with all their heart and soul. They took an oath to the Lord with loud acclamation, with shouting, and with trumpets and horns. And all Judah rejoiced about the oath because they had sworn it wholeheartedly. They sought God eagerly, and he was found by them. So the Lord gave them rest on every side. Peace. A vibrant, fulfilling, joyful Christian life only happens when we serve God wholeheartedly. Well, that doesn't mean every day of our life is going to be happy town, but the fulfillment that we can find in knowing God. Another perk to wholehearted devotion is found in 2 Chronicles 16, verse 9. For the eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. I love that picture. The Lord is seeking the wholehearted in order to strengthen them. Have you ever looked at a Christian you admire and thought, I'd like to be like that person, but I'm not strong like them? But do you see that it's God who strengthens those who commit their hearts fully to him? It's not something we do to earn it, but that we offer. As we give him our heart, our life, he gives us strength. Vance Havner said, too much of our orthodoxy is correct, our doctrine is correct and sound, but like words without a tune, it does not glow and burn. It does not stir the heart. It has lost its hallelujah. Some of us, and I can conclude myself at times, have lost our hallelujah, that joy and wholeheartedness. So let's seek the Lord. Offer our whole heart to him and let him light a fire in our heart again. And I'll give one more plug for our Lenten devotional, and that's really the focus of it, wholehearted devotion up here if you want to grab one. It begins Wednesday, Ash Wednesday. Let's stand and close as we sing one verse, I Surrender. Rejoicing to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, be glory, majesty, power, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen. Go in peace. Amen.